Good afternoon, colleagues, Minister Vaz, Mr. Justice Roy Anderson, Ms. Carolyn Hay, distinguished panelists, Mr. Christopher Malcolm, friends, colleagues. Welcome to another in the Jamaica International Arbitration Center webinar series, Dispute Management in a New World. Today, of course, we address the difficult issue, technology innovation and the changing global environment for dispute management, demystifying the use of artificial intelligence, telemedia, and online dispute resolution in the new world. A rather big, large mouthful, but I think it signifies, of course, the depth of the issue that we have to address. I think whatever happens in the future, we well recognize that things cannot, will never continue as they were in the past. We have to adjust to the new environment. We're grateful, of course, those of us who have the advantage of the Jamaica National Arbitration Center services to be able today, you know, to have our arbitrations addressed virtually, especially those of us who are not comfortable, like me, with the technology. We can have our disputes, our clients' disputes brought before that center, and we can use, of course, the arrangements they have for virtual hearings to make that process a little bit easier. But more important, of course, those of us who are practitioners need to understand what we are talking about. It's not just facilitating the dispute resolution, so understanding what it really means. And we're grateful indeed for the International Arbitration Center's program in bringing these issues to our attention, helping us today to bring with the panel to understand just what it is that we're talking about. Today we have a very, very full program. You know, it would not have been possible, of course, without this sterling effort of Christopher and his team. We want to thank them very, very much for doing what they have done so far in this program. But also, there are a number of persons who we hardly ever see, but without whose support and contribution, we would not have this seminar today. You know, we have, for example, the Caribbean Development Bank. We have AD&D consultants with the Jamaica Standard Products, Jamaica Blueberry Mountain Coffee, Jamaica Stock Exchange, the Guardian Group, Jamaica National Bank, C.P. Malcolm, who is a practitioner, and of course, you know, our leader in this program, the Jamaica Deposit Insurance Corporation, the Exim Bank, Trial Media Litigation Support Services, Caribbean Producers Limited, the Money Musk Rums, Chanaroff Chambers, COK Solidarity Cooperative Credit Union, and of course, Barrett Law. Without their support, physically and financially, we would not have had this discussion. We would not be having this discussion today. And of course, our media partners who help to bring our message to the wider world. Hype TV, Loop News and Trend Media. And of course, all the representatives of the media who are here and who will pick this up hopefully afterwards. We have today the Honorable Daryl Vaz, a Member of Parliament, who is a Minister of Science and Energy and Technology in Jamaica since, I think, September 2020. His responsibilities, of course, include creation of an enabling environment to facilitate access to an alternate source of energy, greater incorporation of science innovation, as well as ensuring universal access to broadband, wireless services, as a right for all Jamaicans, especially, of course, for folks in rural Jamaicans. It's an extremely important and difficult challenge. Those of us, not me happily anymore, but those of us with children understand, of course, the need to address this issue and address it urgently. We have a minister who is taking that on as priority. Having said that, I'm going to ask the colleagues, of course, we can't clap online, of course, that may not be appropriate, but certainly in your hearts and souls, to give me a very warm welcome to our special guest speaker, the Honorable Minister Daryl Vaz, Minister, Member of Parliament. Mr. Vaz?
Thank you very much, Mr. McCoy, and good evening to all the participants. It's a pleasure to be here, despite the fact that we have to do it virtually. So, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, an article entitled Artificial Intelligence and Online Dispute Resolution notes that one concept that has seized the popular imagination is the idea of the digital judge. There is something intuitively appealing about the concept that one day our unruly, chaotic human disputes will be resolved by the cool all-knowing rationality of a fair and impartial electronic decision maker. Had it been several years ago, the concept of technology being used for dispute resolution would have been far-fetched and only a figment of the imagination. But this in 2020, the COVID-19 era, which has fast-tracked many technological processes. Who would have thought that in 2020, judges would be handing down judgments via online platforms? Who would have thought that in 2020, technology would have radically changed the way we seek legal counsel? Technology has disrupted many of the accepted norms of the judicial and legal systems, radically transforming how matters are adjudicated and the way legal advice is dispensed, especially in light of the COVID-19 pandemic, when gatherings are reduced and physical distances is encouraged. Information about arbitrators, past decision making, more generally available through the publication of arbitrator intelligence reports. Ladies and gentlemen, in much the same way that online dispute resolutions is an alternative dispute resolution method, the use of artificial intelligence is another method of resolving issues more effectively. The COVID-19 era has shown that the legal fraternity must adapt to leverage the power of information and communication technologies, ICTs, in order to meet the needs of clients. We no longer have to be in the same physical location to solve our problems, thanks to the power of technology. Legal procedures such as mediation and arbitration can use technology to resolve these matters, whether it is through hardware or software. I must say that technology is a critical tool in our legal arsenal, and I hope that it will be incorporated as much as possible in our legal proceedings. As the International Journal of Online Dispute Resolution states, opportunities are now present for designing powerful systems to both prevent and resolve problems and disputes. I take this opportunity to wish the JAIAC all the very best for this webinar series and beyond. Wish you good luck for the webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much, Minister. Thanks for your help. And let me give open warning to you that we see you as a stakeholder, you know, both in the arbitration field, dispute resolution field, as well as in the science and technology field. So don't be afraid if Christopher comes knocking on your door.
Not a problem.
Thank you very much.
Always available.
Yeah, sure. Colleagues, thank you very much. Colleagues, I'm going to draw your attention now to another member of our community, an arbitrator of great standing, a fellow colleague of mine at the University of West Indies, Mr. Justice Roy Anderson, to bring greetings. Before I do that, let me say a few words about the Honorable Justice Anderson. He's a retired judge of the Supreme Court of Jamaica and the Revenue Court. He's a graduate of UWE, University of London, having degrees in history, in law, at the graduate level in Master of Laws. He also, of course, has an international degree in law from Georgetown University, the Law Center. He is a member of the bar of several jurisdictions, England and Wales, New York, Jamaica, Grenada. I was invited to the Supreme Court bench in Jamaica in 2001. He has wide experience in various areas of law, but most especially commercial law, and has also served as a diplomat in Jamaica's Foreign Service. Since retiring from the Jamaican Supreme Court bench, Mr. Justice Anderson, who is a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Arbitrators and a certified mediator, has worked in the alternative dispute resolution field, as well as in the University of West Indies. As well, I would hate for us not to keep remarking on that fact that he is not only a practitioner, but he's also an educator. At the university, he teaches revenue law and insurance law. And we're very, very honored to have him today and to invite him to bring greetings to this collection at this webinar. Mr. Justice Roy Anderson, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. McCoy. My pleasure to be here. Moderator, Mrs. Caroline Hay, Queen's Counsel, Honorable Minister Vaz, Mrs. Liverpool Jordan, who I believe is representing the President of the CDB, presenters, participants in this webinar all. I'm delighted to bring greetings to you as a member of the Advisory Board of the JAIAC and to participate, who have chosen to participate in this webinar. It's part of our Coffee Time webinar series. I'm pleased that as the JAIAC pursues its mandate, it is premised upon a recognition of the foundational need to not only resolve disputes, but to manage them. It is trite and pellucid that globally, we have come to a point where the digital age is now a fundamental fact of life for all people wherever we are. The pandemic, which has so changed our lives in this year 2020 and forever going forward, has forced us to rethink almost every assumption we have had about how we do business and handle inevitable disputes which come from those processes. Those of us who are actively engaged in the business of resolving disputes through alternative dispute resolution mechanisms, such as arbitration, and away from the strict judicial system or litigation of the courts, are acutely aware of one truth. It is that putting into place mechanisms for managing disputes when, not if, they arise, is critical to the need for persons involved in business and commercial activity to be able to focus on their core activities and not be distracted by problems involved in solving those disputes. And so in this digital age, we're urgently beckoned into the reality of dispute management in this new COVID world. All things, as the Bible says, are passed away. All things are become new. We must recognize that we are catching up with the technology, which is already available and which is not waiting for us to adapt our methods and practices into this new reality. What is more important is the fact that each enhancement of the in digital technology facilitates further and quicker development and shortens the horizons for further improvements and enhancements. As we face this new era, I invite us to commit to focus our collective mind on where we are and what we need to do to ensure that dispute management and resolution is able to fully participate in the revolution of which we are a part and which is moving apace with or without our involvement. My challenge to us, all of us who are a part of this webinar in this regard, is to share the message of dispute management in this new technological area with artificial intelligence and all that goes with it. The management and resolution of disputes is, to my mind, the single most important issue we as humans face, whether it be in families or communities or countries or commercial life or region or internationally. Let us therefore, I would suggest, prepare ourselves to be part of the needed solutions for it. For if we are not, then we will be part of the continuing problems. Let us think about what we would prefer to be, and let us be sure to place ourselves in a position where we are in fact part of that solution rather than part of the problem. As arbitrators, mediators, litigators, and negotiators, I think we have a seminal role to play as the world goes forward. Let us not be found wanting in that regard. Greetings to you all. And I trust that we'll have a wonderfully successful webinar this afternoon.
Very much. I'm honored to see you here participating. You've been a long time mentor and director of mine. And I'd like to say, if I call upon Mr. Kamal Lewis, one of the persons who is making it possible for us to have this webinar this afternoon. Of course, an experienced brand builder. He's from the Caribbean Producers Jamaica Limited. Right, he's a category manager of the spirits and beers portfolio. It's an important area in my consideration, and of course has worked with a host of international brands. So he's a member, a former graduate of the University of Technology in Jamaica. I'm going to ask if we can direct our attention to Mr. Lewis for a few moments on the Caribbean producers to make a meeting.
Hi, good day. My name is Kemar Lewis, category manager here at Caribbean Producers Jamaica Limited. Again, once JAIC came calling as it relates to us sponsoring or partnering with them for this digital webinar series, it was a no-brainer for us. Let me tell you, conflict resolution and management is super important in today's day and age. Again, we decided to sponsor or partner with our finest Jamaican rums that we have as our offerings, and that's Money Musk Plantation Rums. Whispering Breeze, Special Gold, of course, Overproof Right Rum. We have the Classic, which is 8 years old, and then we have the 10-year-old Special Gold Rum. All of these are available online at our cpjmarket.com web address. If you have the time, also follow us online as it relates to Instagram. Thank you. See you then.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kemar. Let me assure my colleagues I have nothing to do with that presentation. That is completely without any influence on my part. Colleagues, may I just continue? An important supporter of the webinar series and these resolution mechanisms in which we engage is the Caribbean Development Bank. We have tonight someone to represent the bank who is, from my perspective, a very, very, very special person. We have today Ms. Nicole Liverpool Jordan. She may object to me saying that calling her Liverpool. But Mrs. Jordan is the acting general counsel of the Caribbean Development Bank, now headquartered in Barbados. For over 20 years, she has been a practicing lawyer, managing various legal teams in New York, London, the Channel Islands, and now Barbados. In her early career, she worked in law firms in the UK and New York before joining a Wall Street investment bank. And she has a significant experience, of course, in legal and financial matters. She is now the general counsel at the Caribbean Development Bank. Nicole?
Thank you very much, and good day to everyone. And thank you to the Jamaica International Arbitration Center for successfully staging another in the Coffee Time webinar series. I'm pleased to bring you greetings from Dr. Warren Smith, who's the president of the Caribbean Development Bank, and regrettably, he couldn't join us today. Rapidly changing digital technology has profoundly altered the way people live, work, interact, and do business. And for all of us, the adoption of technology has been a critical part of the response to the COVID-19 pandemic. This is also true at CDB, as in 2019, we embarked upon a 2-year transformation program to be more closely engaged with our clients. One of the ways in which we intended to do so was by leveraging new technologies to increase the frequency and quality of engagement with our borrowing member countries. By necessity, the adoption of technology in the bank was therefore sped up. We had to quickly adapt to using technology, for example, when holding our quarterly board meetings and electronically signing financing agreements. And staff had to adjust to online connectivity as a substitute for their day in the office. And we already have seen the benefits of the optimization of technology, an improvement in client engagement, an increase in operational efficiency, and a reduction in expenses, which of course makes our president very proud. However, like every other organization across the globe, we were also faced with trials while using the new technology. Internet connectivity issues, both on campus and at the remote locations where our staff was working. Training needs, as some of our staff had not previously had the opportunity to test remote connectivity. Finding alternate secure working spaces, and of course, availability of IT equipment. Every year, the World Bank hosts a week-long seminar series called Law, Justice, and Development Week. This year, with the theme, Legal Responses to the COVID-19 Pandemic, one of the sessions I attended was a discussion on the urgency of online courts for commercial disputes. I've noted some of the improvements and challenges highlighted in that session, which I think are relevant for today's discussion. In some jurisdictions, online courts have been in existence for more than a decade, and the speakers pointed out that online courts have increased access to justice through remote and virtual technology. They're cheaper and faster, there is a notable reduction in backlog, and speedy decision-making processes are ensured. On the other hand, in some of those jurisdictions, many issues persist as litigants lack adequate skills to participate in the process, especially in developing economies, where there is an added difficulty of securing and maintaining expensive digital tools. As a development bank, CDB is keen to ensure that vulnerable people in the region benefit from the democratization of technology, that justice gaps are closed, and no litigant is left behind. The growing volume of disputes and lawsuits due to the pandemic will adversely affect litigants who already lack access to courts and arbitration centers. We have seen some of these playing out in the press already. For example, pandemic-related death or injury lawsuits, commercial and contractual disputes, real estate affairs, bankruptcy and insolvency, labor relations, consumer complaints, insurance liability, domestic violence, and family law cases. These and other matters will no doubt be addressed by our most capable panelists this afternoon. The Caribbean Development Bank is proud to be a sponsor of JAIAC's Coffee Time webinar series, and we wish the participants all the best in today's deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nicole. Thank you. Colleagues, we have another word, if we would. Again, from a very special person to me, that is the Jamaica Stock Exchange. And we're going to call upon Mr. Andre Gooden to give us a few words, greetings from a message, really, from the Jamaica Stock Exchange. Andre is a very experienced portfolio manager and investment counselor. Is engaged for long-term financial planning, commercial banking, stockbroking, and project management. Of course, he's held several positions in large financial institutions in Jamaica and abroad. At present, of course, he's a group business development manager at the Jamaica Stock Exchange, where his responsibilities include identifying and developing strategic business relationships, regional, and of course, to take the lead in development of new business opportunities. He is, as I said, to me, a very important person, my perspective, and I'm very glad that he has associated himself and the organization with which we're both associated, Jamaica Stock Exchange, with this webinar today. So I'd now like to call upon Andre, of course, to give us a message. Andre.
Good afternoon. My name is Andre Gooden. I'm the Group Business Development Manager at the Jamaica Stock Exchange. And on behalf of the Stock Exchange, I want to express great pride and appreciation for us being involved in this seminar here today. At the Jamaica Stock Exchange, we rely heavily on technology to enable wealth creation in Jamaica and around the world. Similarly, our other platform, the Jamaica Social Stock Exchange, uses the same technology platform to enable long-term tangible solutions to social problems, including dispute resolution. So, you see, we have a stake in the game. So we look forward to learning more about how we can utilize technology to solve disputes, and we wish you a very successful seminar today. Thank you.
Thank you, Andre. Colleagues, we are running a little behind time, so I think it's time for me to get off your screen and to introduce Ms. Caroline Hay, Queen's Counsel. She is a leader of the Jamaican Bar. She's a founding partner of Hay Law. She's a member of our advisory board at the JAIAC, and of course, the person who's responsible today for managing this discourse. She's a moderator. So I'm going to, at this point, turn proceedings over to Caroline, and she will take it from here. Caroline?
Thank you so much, Prof. I really appreciate the invitation from the JAIAC, and let me start by doing the shortcut way to say to all the important and second-tier important guests today, all protocols observed, good afternoon. Welcome to all. To this installment of Coffee Time, the webinar. If you looked at your flyer, you would have seen that it was introduced as a reasoning. And the first sponsor for our session actually provides us with the liquid enabling to reasoning, a sort of mellow type of background set to what we're intending to do today. I see Anil smiling already. It must be true. So the point of this, ladies and gentlemen, is to have a very relaxed discussion talk where we're going to invite you to send your questions, discussion on this increasingly relevant look, increasingly urgent treatment of how technology is taking over dispute resolution. And there are going to be the tensions between the wanting to engage on the human level with the sense and physical feel of a dispute in its setting and the efficiencies of technology. But I'm not the speaker, I'm just the moderator. So what I'll do in this short overview time is introduce you to your speakers in the order in which they'll address you. And then I'll tell you how we plan to deal with the 50 minutes allocated to us. And we really want to have the participants ask questions. They are experts, trust me on that. So let me start off by introducing Professor Iria Giuffrida. I hope I got her name right. She tells me she's Italian. And I see a message that the volume is low, so let me try and speak up. If it's improved, you let me know. So Iria is a professor of the practice at William and Mary Law School and is a deputy director of the Center for Legal and Court Technology. She also holds the position of visiting faculty for business law at the Raymond A. Mason School of Business. Professor Giuffrida has been working on a grant-funded research project focusing on legal issues arising from the increasing use of artificial intelligence, the rapid growth of the Internet of Things, and related emerging technologies. In her previous professional life, she was a commercial litigator with Deschert, London and Brussels, and NEO Law LLP, a big-ticket specialist litigation firm in London, during which time she gained substantial experience in alternative dispute resolution, especially arbitration. So that's Prof. Iria. So then we're going to talk to Jesse Francis. He's the director of trial consulting and presentation for Trial Media and Trial Concierge Services. He's a trainee, born in Port of Spain, Trinidad. He attended St. George's College. He has a law degree from the University of Miami and an MBA from Florida Atlantic University. He has provided consulting services to Hewlett-Packard, Samsung, Johnny Walker, more of the reasoning, Johnson & Johnson, Samson Merck, UBS, Walmart, Royal Caribbean Cruise Lines, Carnival Cruise Lines, and Bacardi in the US, Panama, Colombia, London, Madrid, St. Kitts, Jamaica, the BVI. Arbitration firms have included the ICC, ICSID, World Bank, UNCITRAL, London Court of International Arbitration, AAA, JAMS, and FINRA. Dispute types that he's exposed to: breach of contract, international patent, cruise line injury, insurance claims, and commercial construction. During arbitration, he has assisted counsel with the selection, preparation, and presentation of electronic exhibits, including electronic demonstrative aids using industry standard software. Additionally, his company provides Zoom or remote hosting services. So that's Jesse. And finally, way in the morning, I believe, in Singapore, is Anil, who's very flexible, I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen. Whenever you have a meeting, no matter the time of day or night, Anil is available. He's an accredited mediator with the Singapore Mediation Center, Singapore Family Justice Court, Asian International Arbitration Center, Vietnam International Commercial Mediation Center, and the International Dispute Resolution Risk Management Institute. He's an arbitrator, a fellow of the Chartered Singapore and Philippines Institutes of Arbitrators. He practices is trained as an adjudicator and in international treaty arbitration at the AIAC. And he is the Dispute Resolution Board Foundation's country representative for Singapore. He's an advocate and solicitor of Singapore since 1995, long before I was born. A solicitor of England and Wales, 2009, nobody believes me. Qualified as a barrister at law in Middle Temple of England and Wales in 1993, and holds a Master of Science in Construction Law and Arbitration from King's College London and National University of Singapore in 2006. He's the Dispute Resolution Board Foundation's country representative of Singapore. Having practiced with an international firm and in-house and served as an infantry officer with the Singapore Armed Forces for 5 years, his law practice, Changaroth Chambers, LLC, and legal consultancy, Changaroth International Consultancy, advises and acts for clients in the Asia-Pacific region, including mainly with infrastructure and construction and facilitating Singapore's infrastructure, Asia, the Singapore Convention on Mediation, China's Belt and Road Initiative, and the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement. He's widely published and obviously very important. Ladies and gentlemen, before we get to our panel, there are some additional messages, I believe, from other sponsors. So I'll stop speaking now, allow you to finish listening to those, and then we'll get into what's going to be a fascinating time. Reasoning, hopefully none of the panelists has done any indulging in the drinking just yet, but at the time when, when we have the music, maybe they will.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm Freddie Pragnell, Head, Digital Banking at JN Bank. JN Bank is pleased to be your partner for this, the third iteration of the Dispute Management in a New World webinar series under the theme Technology, Innovation, and the Changing Global Environment for Dispute Management. As the world embraces digitalization in virtually all areas, it is necessary to apply these concepts to dispute management, a discipline and skill set that I am certain will continue to remain relevant. I commend Dr. Christopher Malcolm and the rest of the JAIAC team for organizing this webinar and including a panel of international experts who can bring various perspectives and clarity to the subject matters of artificial intelligence, telemedia, and online dispute resolution. The Jamaica National Group has been carving out a niche of its own using artificial intelligence and other forms of digital technology and innovations to include smart ATMs, our award-winning BizPay Central Payroll Service from MC Systems, and short-term motor insurance from JNGI, as well as a unique critical illness life insurance policy from JN Life Insurance. Once again, JN Bank is proud to be your partner. We look forward to another refreshing and stimulating discussion.
Good day, everyone. I'm Siret Sibel, Chief Business Development Officer here at COK Sodality Cooperative Credit Union. COK Sodality is pleased to support the Jamaica International Arbitration Center's Dispute Management Webinar Series. With this webinar's focus on innovation, particularly in the digital space, we see the JAIAC's efforts as particularly important for us in the financial services industry. With an over 50-year history of innovation ourselves here at COK, we look forward to what the rest of this webinar series has to offer, especially in this changing world where the embracing of technology and innovation are paramount. We hope you find this webinar series insightful and exciting.
Thank you. Okay, so let's dive right in. Professor Jufridi, she's going to open the batting for us. I don't know if in where she is, cricket is a big deal, but she's been in London.
I've been there long enough that I really need to understand the basics. Thank you very much, Caroline, and of course, a word of gratitude to the organizers, the JAIAC, and the speakers, the eminent speakers that preceded me. What I'm going to try to do is I prepared a short PowerPoint presentation, and I will probably take about 15 minutes of my time. I've got a timer in front of me. I am known for speaking a lot, so I'm going to try to curtail myself. So I hope that you can bear with me as I share the screen and get the presentation started. Good. So what I wanted to do in the next few minutes is to take you and the attendees over a very quick journey of the kind of work that I've been doing over the last 3.5 years. As Caroline mentioned at the beginning, the origin of my work is funded by a grant from Cisco Systems Inc. that asked us to sort of start thinking about what are the likely legal issues that may arise from the great increase in technology. And I need to emphasize at the beginning of this work, it was pre-pandemic. So the pandemic has certainly been an accelerating factor, and every speaker today has mentioned the importance for us as lawyers or any businesses needing legal services, as well as individuals, sort of understanding the impact of technology. And so what you have here in this slide is sort of the early findings of the work that we have, that we've done. And sort of this was sort of quite at the beginning. And the findings were that in the legal profession, there is a certain degree of pride in not being technologically savvy. And this is not just in practice, but it is also in academia. And this is a problem because we simply cannot shut our mind to the kind of challenges that this kind of technologies are bringing. And the second aspect, so the second key point of our research was relating to the kind of work of specialism that we saw around. We saw a lot of lawyers specializing in one specific type of technology and legal implications of it, and not looking at how this sort of interplays in the real world. So here comes sort of the thesis of our work, which is that in fact we are living, and certainly over the last 12 months, we have experienced an acceleration of what we call the AI ecosystem, which is a sort of imagine it as a world that's sort of superimposed, as a cyber world that is superimposed to in the physical world. Now, the two don't simply live as parallel to each other, but they interact, the physical and the cyber and vice versa. And I think that there is where I really want to, and where I encourage my students to pay a lot of attention, is the impact from the cyber to the physical. They're not, as I said, two separate universes, but they overlap. And sort of this slide sort of tries to summarize how they interact with each other. And the key component of the this AI ecosystem and growing is data. And data is what I'm absolutely sure Jesse will be talking about when he introduces us to some of the challenges and the solutions that AI can provide in the world of e-discovery. But going back to sort of the more abstract world of, sort of the work that I am doing, data ties in all these different kinds of technologies. The one that attracts the most attention and the one that I really want to talk to you about today is artificial intelligence. We're lawyers in the room, at least most of us are lawyers, and we really want a definition. What is artificial intelligence? And this could take a really, really long time. I'm going to give you sort of a word of warning about artificial intelligence, especially in the commercial world. We're seeing solutions that are sophisticated being labeled as having artificial intelligence when probably they do not have artificial intelligence. I had to sort of try to give you a representation of what artificial intelligence looks like. I think that many of you imagine it a little bit like this, right? We have this extremely sophisticated artificial brain, and in some cases even manifested in a corporeal element. But in fact, when I talk to my students, artificial intelligence looks a little bit more like this. And by this, I mean, it really is a kind of alien amongst us. And I had a discussion, or at least this conclusion has come up, having spoken to a cybersecurity specialist, and in particular, he's a cryptographer. And we were trying to talk about artificial intelligence, and I'll move into the definition in a minute. But he said to me, essentially, from the scientific perspective, artificial intelligence is a kind of technology that it is so advanced that our current theories are not capable of explaining it, how it works. And so he said this, he talked to me and he said, you know, it is an alien. It's an alien amongst us, and we're looking at it and we're studying it exactly as if it were an alien. And I thought that was quite a fascinating way of starting to think about AI. So an alien amongst us, an alien that can be extremely good, that good old ET, that is sort of there and just wants to make a call home, but it does hide a darker side, which is where I think us as practitioners and lawyers need to be at least aware of what the complications are likely to be. And so let's just go with what I think is a very useful chart to try to summarize what artificial intelligence is. Artificial intelligence is really an overall term that I would call, consider sort of an umbrella term that includes different kinds of data processing and data management technologies. So it all starts with algorithms, and we've heard of algorithms, and you know, some of us have had to study, not personally, at university. Algorithm is just a way of resolving particular problems. AI is embedded in algorithms, but not all algorithms are an indication of artificial intelligence being there. artificial intelligence in the common sense, what you and I are likely to have found and have been exposed to, including in our, I've got a smartphone here, the smartphone has some AI capabilities, is the latter term. So the subcategory below artificial intelligence, which is machine learning. Machine learning is a technique that relies on algorithms and is capable of absorbing vast universes of data, processing them, and changing itself as a consequence of the data that has the system has been exposed to. So for instance, machine learning, if any of you has ever used Google Translate, if you'd used it a few years ago, it was quite clunky. You couldn't put too many sentences in the box because the translation would be very stiff and quite literal. If you use Google Translate today, the translation is extremely accurate, and it is also capable of translating a voice message from one language to the other instantaneously. This is because the machine learning systems behind it have amended themselves, have learned from the data input and output. It's mostly structured learning and supervised learning, but I'm not going to spend too much time discussing it, and have improved the system itself. Now, within the category of machine learning, there's a more advanced technique called deep learning or neural networks, which is the technique that the scientist I was talking to a few minutes ago discussed or described as the alien in the room. And the deep or neural networks is a sort of a visualization of how algorithms are organized and how they resolve problems. And there are several layers. The more sophisticated systems like Google, so the Google AI has at least 200 to 300 layers of deep neural networks that sort of process data and provide output. And what my colleague explained to me is that from a mathematical perspective or theoretical perspective, we have a theory that can explain how the first three layers of neural networks work. Past that point, it is all a black box. And I think you've heard this, the black box problem that is connected with AI. And if I had to say simply what it is, it's our inability to explain how the system got from one point to another. So from data that is input in the system to a particular output the system provided. Now, it is possible to statistically determine what are the likely factors that assisted the system or that the system relied on to move from one factor to from input to output. But that is all just that, that is what it is. It's just a statistical analysis. And this is the challenge number one for us lawyers. Essentially, I'm a deterministic person. My understanding of technology is deterministic. So what does that mean? It means that I was raised with the understanding that if I press a particular key on the keyboard of my laptop and I'm in Word, as I press the key F and I'm in Word, the letter F will appear on the screen. This is because the system has been coded to respond in a very specific, in a determined way to my input. When we're talking about artificial intelligence, the input output is no longer determined. It's subject to what is extremely sophisticated black box kind of statistical analysis. So the output that you're likely to see, the output that you see is an output determined by statistics and not just by predetermined coding. And the coding itself, if you wish, of the AI system changes itself. This is why it is a challenge for technical experts, let alone lawyers, in trying to understand not necessarily what has happened, but more importantly, how and why an AI system has taken data in one sense and has provided a particular output. Now, we could be talking about what AI is for a really long time, but the purpose of today's talk is to try to think about how does that impact dispute resolution, in particular, alternative dispute resolution. And I have two simple answers, although I'm sure that the incredibly complicated concepts, but the two simple answers or thoughts to bring to today's seminar are as follows. The first one is that there's going to be issues that the arbitrators in the room and counsel in the room are going to face in the natural kind of disputes, commercial disputes or family disputes that they will naturally be involved in. Where artificial intelligence poses very serious challenges is in the context of privacy and data security, because the system work or how AI operates is defies the clear rules of privacy. And just to give you an example, let's assume that some data has been taken out of my computer system without my consent. And let's assume that I'm sort of under the GDPR kind of regime. I can call for that data to be returned to me. That may well be fine, you know, the data may be returned, but you can never actually take the data out of the AI system. And let me give you an example. Imagine a four-year-old, and imagine that you take this four-year-old in a room and ask the child to understand, to look around, leave the child alone for a couple of minutes. The child will look around to get a sense of where the door is, what the furniture looks like, the colors, where the window is, etc. You can then take the child out of the room and try to tell the child, forget what you have seen in the room. And this is a challenge that I think those of the participants who are actually judges with juries have had in their career. Try to tell a jury, please forget, disregard this particular fact. But once the knowledge is there, it may be disregarded, but the knowledge is there. Same with AI. Once the data is in the system, you can try to ask the system to disregard it, but you can never really take it out. And so this poses immense challenges for privacy practitioners. There are, I have been working a lot in terms of civil liability, the degree to which artificial intelligence skews our clear understanding of how liability falls, whether it's contractual liability or extra-contractual liability. I'm not going to talk into too many details. Certainly smart contracts are going to be new issues for the adjudicators and the counsel in the room they're going to have to deal with. And there's a number of other areas that I sort of list on the slide. The takeaway point that I would like to leave the audience with is an acknowledgement that we tend to consider technology as neutral. Technology is not neutral. Technology inherits the biases and the worldview of their makers. And you would have heard of a number of problems that have occurred in, for instance, AI systems that do facial recognition. And there is a fantastic scientist, I just pulled the slide up, Joy Bulamini, who has been doing a lot of work to try to explain to big tech companies the flaws that their facial recognition systems have. And the two images that you have in front of you are Joy Bulamin in front of a computer system with facial recognition. The first picture on the left, the facial recognition technology does not even acknowledge that there's a human face in front of it. On the picture on the right, she placed a completely blank mask over her face. The system recognizes that there is a face. Now, this is a major challenge. So my takeaway for us practitioners who are going to have to deal with either problems caused by technology or using technology in our daily activities is to be conscious of the fact that technology is not neutral. In fact, there's an article, a very interesting article that reminds us of what's the politics of an artifact. And as we use it, and I think Anil will be telling us in practice how we can use technology to even resolve dispute, we just need to be conscious of the fact that we may be bringing some bias in the context, and therefore some litigants may be affected detrimentally by this process. I think I want to wrap it up here because time is running and then maybe some questions will be asked later. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Professor. That's fascinating. You know, I don't consider myself any form of technology buff at all. I am kicking and screaming in the modern world. But the two things that I had not thought about, which you have identified as challenges, have to do with the fact that there are privacy and data. Sorry, my timer went off. And here is another technology example. I'm trying to turn it off and it won't turn on.
And I'm trying to stop sharing. There you go. technology has.
If you bear with me, my timer has gone. It keeps going, so I've turned it off. Good, there's technology. But the two takeaways for me, the challenges that we're facing now in this modern world. privacy and data security. And when Jesse comes to talk us through the capacity to take large swatches of data and put them in intelligible form to understand the mechanic parts, the moving parts of a dispute, there are the ongoing privacy issues and the fact that you just cannot forget things. I have 5 children. So when you use that example of a 4-year-old, it struck me, you know, how do you forget where the cookie jar is? But also that technology is not neutral, and I had never heard it before as a thought, that it really repeats and it absorbs the biases of the creator. So these are real issues in relation to how to present to neutral, objective, fair decision makers with the use of technology, all of what they need to be able to make decisions. Fascinating. Thank you so much for opening the batting for us. Jesse, who I know is going to take us through a very interesting screen shared discussion, is going to talk to us a little bit about the technology that may or may not be biased, that helps us to handle large volumes of data to understand the moving parts of disputes. Jesse.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, and for some folks, good night. I'm Jesse Francis, and I'll be presenting on technology innovation and the changing global environment, telemedia and online dispute resolution. So let's look at a few things. First of all, my definition of telemedia for arbitration specifically, you know, the ability to empower client success during arbitrations. And it's also specifically defined by the client and the use of technology. So let's just take one step back, you know, before, you know, any technology had been used in an arbitration. We had boxes of documents and then binders where paper was placed into binders. Well, now let's talk about pre-COVID. So we're talking about before March, you know, or before late December of 2019. So here's an example of an arbitration setup in Panama City. So we have the top left here, we have 3 arbitrators that are looking at monitors, you know, with documents, which is exactly what we have today after COVID, but they're not socially distant. And then we have a translator here in a booth that's basically translating from English to Spanish. And here's one of our council table here, and then another set of council table over here. So let's go now to a larger arbitration. Again, now four parties, 40 attorneys in a larger conference room, but again, not socially distant at all. Finally, British Virgin Islands in 2019, December of 2019. Again, we have about 10 people in a conference room. Again, looking at a screen, but we're not using any remote technology. So now let's look at 2020 post-COVID adjustments for remote hearings, hybrid remote hearings, and on-site social distance, and also some foreign country consideration that I can discuss if there are any questions about that. So first thing, when we talk about a remote arbitration, we're talking about a remote platform, Zoom, like we're using now, then we have WebEx, BlueJeans, and various other platforms. Well, this also depends on what type of setup you have. So here's a setup where 4 people are in a conference room, you know, in St. Kitts in the West Indies, literally this month. And here we have one attorney sitting here, another attorney sitting over here, another attorney is over here, and here I am sitting in this seat here while we're showing the exhibits to opposing side and parties literally on both sides of the world, as in one party is in Europe and another party is in Canada, but the West Coast of Canada, basically California. Well, not California, but basically Northern, Western Canada on California time. So here's another arbitration that took place, actually it's 2 of them that took place in Miami in July and August of this year. Again, socially distanced, if you look at the top, you'll see one of the attorneys looking at his dual screens here. Here's an actual zoom in of that where he's looking at documents. You know, he has his outline on one screen. He has also highlighted documents on another screen. Here I am sitting here at the arbitration. This is my setup here as far as having, you know, a laptop, a screen that shows the documents that are there. And even in this arbitration here, we had parties that were connecting from Honduras, Jamaica and Greece, if I'm not mistaken, as far as parties to the arbitration, even though this arbitration here was technically a US-based arbitration. So how do we manage, you know, the documents and volume of documents and arbitration? Well, there are a number of different ways. And one of the standards that almost everyone knows now is a PDF. That's a document. And now a lot of the online databases allows you to input these PDFs into the database itself, where you can call it whatever you want, number one, number two, number three, A, B, C, D. And then you can actually pull up different sections of the document on screen and show everyone. And before COVID, this would be showing up on a monitor in front of someone in a conference room. Now it's being shown, like I'll show you now, via Zoom, just many people in many different jurisdictions, many different time zones. What the technology also enables you to do is basically create snapshots of documents. So basically I can go through here and look at a certain page and then create a call out of that document so that when everyone is looking at a document, you can say, well, let's take a look at paragraph 3.2 on page 313. And then you're able to see exactly what it is that you're talking about. You can always see the entire page, but that zooms in and focuses the person testifying as far as what you want them to see. So now I'm going to talk about some static demonstrative, dynamic demonstrative, interactive demonstratives, and also the pre-hearing inclusion of static and dynamic demonstratives. And this is basically for effectiveness and efficiency, because the problem with especially doing something online, you have to be effective, but you also have to be efficient, especially in arbitrations where most folks know now that they are usually timed arbitrations when one party might get 20 hours, another party might get 20 hours, and you have to present as much information to the arbitrators in a short period of time. So this is a static demonstrative where basically we're just showing, you know, a picture or a screenshot of something where a witness or an expert witness is testifying about some type of port capacity in a certain country. So now let's talk about a dynamic demonstrative, where again, it starts off as a static demonstrative. And if we look at this black line going through here, that is a railway line. And we are seeing that as it stands right now, we have one train over here and another train over here. They can exist on the same railway line at the same time, but at some point in time, this train here will have to move over to this top line at El Paso because this train needs to pass and they obviously cannot crash into each other. So let's go to the dynamic portion of it where I click on enter and then a red line appears. So now instead of having two trains, we can now have six trains. So basically triple the amount of trains on the same two lines, or an additional line, I should say. So now here comes the part where we tie everything in, especially in arbitration when we talk about damages. So we just saw the fact that if we went from two trains to six trains, we can increase volume, and increased volume means increased dollars of revenue. So we're seeing here that from 2000 to 2005, there was some growth from 10 million to 20 million. But then without that second line, growth basically flatlined from around, you know, basically around 20 million to 25 million. But here's the thing, let's show when we add in the extra line, what happens. Well, now we're showing that it goes from 25 million up to almost 45 million. So that there is extra damages that a party can claim during an arbitration, and showing the arbitrators this here, yes, we can talk about the fact that here's what happens and show them numbers, but showing them something graphically, we are able to actually show them exactly what it is that we have in this case. So now, most cases obviously involve some type of timeline. I'm going to talk and scroll through this while it's going. So basically here we have, and for those of you who know, Diageo is Johnny Walker, but we have a timeline of meetings that occurred. And of course, there are a lot of meetings that occurred here. So what we're going to do and what we're showing the arbitrators is basically, look, there were a lot of meetings that took place during this process. So it goes and it's going to fill in here. So that was 2014, a little bit later in 2014, still 2014, And now we're going to eventually get to 2015, you know. And here's another thing. And the interesting thing, I'm actually telling you this, that the answer to the question here is a 450-day delay on a Panama airport a roofing construction project. So here we have a timeline of the actual construction project. Obviously, it's in Spanish, but I'm pretty sure even if you don't speak Spanish, you'll understand the theory that I'm talking about. So first of all, we have, you know, a document that shows, you know, an agreed progress report. We have a date here, and, you know, obviously we're showing that something's highlighted. So now let's go to an engineering drawing. Again, this might be something that an expert witness is talking about. So now we go and we show different portions. This is basically a side view of the actual roof structure that goes onto the new airport terminal in Panama City, Panama. We're going through here. So now we're going to look at the timeline starting in August 2014, going up to October 2015. So now we're going to take the engineering drawing at the top, but also superimpose pictures as far as from November 2014, November 21st, 2014, November 27th, showing the progress of the construction project. Now we jump to April 2015 and we're showing that, okay, here we go. Here's what's happening here. Again, April 30th, you know, another picture. July 2015, another picture. So basically nothing much is happening. And then, like I said, the answer to the question is that 450 days from August of 2014 until October of 2015 is a construction delay. And for the attorneys in the room that know about construction and construction delays, obviously that equals a lot of damages. So let me stop sharing my screen for 1 second. And I apologize because I'm actually using dual screens to show this presentation. Now I'm going to show you the actual trial presentation database that I use. So let me, first of all, share my screen again. Okay, hold on. There we go. So here we have the actual construction database. So let me go to page one of this document here. So for those of you, again, who deal with construction, you will see that this is a FITIC contract. So now we want to go to various sections of this contract. So I'm actually going to put two sections on one page. Let me go ahead and pull up page one again here on the left, go to page five. So now let me go to the right-hand side, and then let's go to page seven. We have two different sections of the contract on the same page. So now I'm going to talk about the employer's financial arrangements. So we can have that here, but then we're going to talk about a designation by the engineer. So yet again, like I said, you know, you can use, you know, a standard PDF to create these annotations. Here I'm going to, you know, let's make it a little bit fancier. Let's go with green here to show that we have different points that we're trying to show as far as what's happening, you know, within the actual document. But again, we are able to focus the arbitrator's attention to the document. Obviously, the witness might want to testify about a different section, but we on cross-examination want to make sure that they are focused in on section 2.4 and section 3.2. And if the witness wants to go to section 3.1, well, we can go ahead right here and, you know, highlight this. The engineer shall have no authority to amend the contract. That's what the witness wanted to testify about, but we don't want to testify about that. We want to testify about the delegation by the engineer. So here we go here. Another thing that this software allows you to do is that you can actually show a video testimony. So let me go ahead here. And now let me go ahead and play a quick video clip.
Doctor, could you please state your name for the record?
Dr. Wayne Fraser.
Are you employed, doctor?
Yeah, self-employed.
Okay.
So again, now we are able to show some video of someone testifying at a matter. Now, here's one other thing, actually a couple other things that you can do, and some I'm pretty sure some folks have done this in the past, where basically you have a PDF document, this witness statement of an engineer. Now, of course, there are going to be footnotes to the actual witness statement, but you can also, in addition to hyperlinking in other PDFs, well, we can actually hyperlink in a PowerPoint presentation. So let me go ahead and click on that. Now, I just need to bring this over to the other screen. Let me bring this over here. And now let me go back and share that screen so you can all see it. So now you'll see that we're talking about an expert witness testifying about a construction project. He reviewed these documents here. He reviewed the work performed. He reviewed the project timeline. So now he's talking about, well, here's what happened, you know, during the construction project from his point of view. And he says basically, foundation was laid. Eventually something was built. It was a gas station. But guess what? If you look right here, they're actually leaking tanks, but we will actually get to that. They're leaking underground tanks, leads to groundwater contamination, well table contamination, artesian well contamination, and finally, we have a lawsuit. But his basic principle is talking about a sand versus clay analysis. So again, even though we're using demonstratives, he's going to talk about the fact that there's poor water pressure, applied stress, and it's a different type of stress between sand and clay. Here we go right here. And then basically that's where he came up with his conclusion as far as what happened in this case. Now, one final thing that I'm going to show you is, you know, what's called a dynamic presentation. So now basically this is almost like a web page, and basically is a web page, because as you can see here, it's actually coming in from an actual web page document. But this was created by someone at my company. And now we're going to again show a view of a construction project. So now let's look at some layers in here. So by clicking through here, similar to PowerPoint, I can show different things here, but again, it's dynamic. So now I want to talk about water flow. So I can go here, back to balcony, talk about debris damage, back to balcony, additional damage where I'm actually incorporating pictures into it. And then again, if I want to go back to the main balcony and the construction layer, then okay, let me talk about the deck or flashing. And again, these are all things that can be incorporated into an expert witness at arbitration with their expert report. So basically when the other side has the opportunity to cross-examine the expert during arbitration, when your attorneys have the opportunity to re-examine or redirect those experts, they can refer to these documents because they were created before the actual arbitration hearing, that they can say, this is why we are doing or opining on what happened, because here's what we think happened versus something else not happening. So again, part of the thing is it's not only the actual at arbitration presentation, but also the pre-arbitration presentation, where the thought process, as far as especially expert witnesses, when they're giving their expert testimony, that you're able to incorporate certain demonstratives into that PDF, so that not for his direct testimony, yes, it will be used and will probably be seen by the arbitrators, but when that witness gets cross-examined, then you're able to, on redirect, say, well, here's why we need to do certain things because of what I stated below. And basically, that is it. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Jesse. I knew it was going to be as good as the last time. Probably it's better than the last time because it's really a visual as to how we can use really large swatches or complex arguments that are really being disputed over by, say, businesses in different countries, persons affected at different levels of the dispute. It really is fascinating to use technology to be able to present the story in an understandable way. And every advocate, every decision maker wants to understand the story. So thank you so much for showing us where the world is now going so that I can actually stay in my office and understand the story, even though it's originating all the way in Singapore, where Anil is now. So ladies and gentlemen, we remember in this reasoning that we're not just talking about AI, we're talking about telemedia, we're also talking about online dispute resolution and how all of those intersect with the fact that humans evolve really, but not so much, and that a lot of our issues, even though we use technology, still remain very simple. They just get complicated by lots of other different interruptions. But I'm not going to take over Anil's talk. I want to invite Anil to make his presentation now and to invite you to start sharing your questions in the online chat so that I can detect them and begin to put them to the speakers, because we've tried our best to carve time in for you to ask your questions. Welcome, Anil.
Right, thank you. Good morning, all the way from Singapore. What I'm going to be doing is I'm going to try and put together what Professor Iria spoke about, the AI ecosystem and Jesse's use of technology, both static, dynamic, interactive, demonstratives, into what is now a catchphrase, online dispute resolution. And I think the best way to deal with that, I'm just going to go through a brief summary of it. And the best way to set the framework is, I think, what our keynote speakers spoke about this morning or earlier today. The Honorable Justice had spoken about digital judge, the AI and infocom technology. Justice Anderson had spoken about catching up with technology and dispute management and resolution. And Ms. Jordan had spoken about online courts. Now, if you put all of those things together, it all comes down to one catchphrase, online dispute resolution, something that's been accelerated now in the pandemic. And I think the best way to describe it is this. It's a quote from Albert Einstein. He said that we cannot solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used to when we created them. All right. So that sets the framework of what I'm going to speak about. And to start off, I'd like to just share a couple of points. The Chief Justice of Singapore, Mr. Justice Sundaresh Menon, in an opening address to the legal year in 2019, that is last year, right? Every year in January, he opens the legal year and he speaks to the fraternity. And this is what he said. He said, over time, the content of law will change as new areas of law and legal principles emerge in response to technological advances. Right, and we must all keep abreast of the development in technology in order to grapple with the legal issues that come before us. And key to that, he said, was automated dispute resolution systems may in time diminish the flow of cases that form the backbone of the development of common law. So he's talking about automated dispute resolution. And when you talk about automated dispute resolution, you automatically think about what Professor Iria said about artificial intelligence, or what you said, what Jesse said about demonstratives, how you know, you can showcase your case in a far more demonstrative manner, so much so that people can appreciate what is going on. So for example, when he spoke about the 460 odd days of delay, he showed it in a graphical manner where you see all of the dates on which events take place. And when you see graphically, you appreciate the kind of extent of the problems they will face. So, you know, automated dispute resolution is a key area. He also, the same Chief Justice, when he addressed the mass call, that means when the lawyers were being called to the bar, right, he urged the legal profession to reskill to adapt to the new reality that technology is already beginning to displace lawyers from some areas of practice. So the question then you have is this: would artificial intelligence displace lawyers and then the work that the lawyers do? I may not go too much into it, but I'll just give you an overview of what I think about where it's going to go, right? That brings us then to this thing about online dispute resolution. And, you know, COVID-19, the pandemic, is dramatically disrupting how work and society functions. Social distancing is resulting in a greater use of technology for communication and interactions. And courts and dispute resolution institutes are moving away from the traditional form of resolving business disputes and instead adopting online dispute resolution mechanisms and platforms. Basically, what you mean by ODR, it's a use of internet and web-based technology through communication that both synchronous, continuous video conferencing or asynchronistic approaches at dealing with disputes, leaving face-to-face interactions only if necessary. So it's a platform where you can interact with the other party without having to be in the same room at the same time, right? Now, historically, online dispute resolution, the best example of that was eBay, right? It had over many years resolved close to 60 million small consumer disputes annually through use of online dispute resolution. And if you go and do a little bit of research on eBay, you realize that some of them use algorithms and artificial intelligence to resolve the disputes. But those are all very small scale disputes. Now, how do you then take that to a larger platform? How do you then take that to considering online court systems and so on? Right. What it does is basically this. A best way to give you an example is that the International Chamber of Commerce reported that online dispute resolution platforms have appeared over two decades ago, offering online processes for different types of disputes, and those have grown exponentially. And especially in the COVID-19 pandemic, it's you know, from about April this year, all we've been seeing is things that are online. I've had over the last 3 or 4 months dealt with arbitration hearings online with my clients in China and the other parties all over the world. I've dealt with mediation online. I've dealt with court appearance in criminal matters online, mitigating pleas and cross examinations going online. Now, if you talk about that, a great example would be the Chinese Ministry of Justice and Supreme Court. On the 3rd of March this year, they issued guidelines emphasizing the importance of ODR for jumpstarting the economy. And it's gone on to a massive platform where a lot of cases in China are being dealt with online. The latest move, the Chinese have made the latest move in a strategy to develop the internet judiciary, right? Following the Supreme Court's December 2019 white paper that I outlined the measures to improve the court online system. It is basically to move court dispute resolution mechanisms online and to expedite it and then move it along a lot faster than it ever was before, right? Now, Jesse had briefly spoken about online platforms, and let me just give you quick examples of these. For example, you have service providers such as the International Arbitration Center and International Dispute Resolution Center in UK, the Chinese International Economic and Trade Arbitration Commission's Online Dispute Resolution Center, or the Russian Arbitration Center Online System of Arbitration. These are service providers that gives you a platform on which you can go get your disputes resolved online. Now, some of the other platforms, Jesse mentioned this, Zoom, you have Microsoft Teams, you have Skype for Business, and you've got BlueJeans. And there are service tools that you can use. Some of the tools that Jesse gave you examples of and showed you are mainly used in the construction industry. There are other tools like Immediate, found from in Australia. There's Opus 2, there's Resolve Dispute Online. So if you go take a Google check on these, you find a lot of facilities available for you for using online dispute resolution mechanisms. Some of the benefits of it is that cost savings, convenience, because you can just sit there at your leisure or at a venue that you're most comfortable with, and you can get onto a platform and then deal with the matters that you have at hand. Eco-friendly, that's a big thing, because you know, Jesse kind of alluded to this about documents and all that. In a lot of matters now that I deal with, actually I have been dealing with this for several years now. 2 years ago in a shipping arbitration that I had conducting, my team had just two MacBooks with us with all our documents loaded on the Mac, and the opposing side had a table full of documents. And every time the arbitrator or any of the parties wanted to look at the documents, we'd be able to pull it up a lot faster on our computer. And we'll say, you know, volume 10, page 2,550, and this is where it is. Whereas you'd find the opposing party flipping through the documents physically. So you have this thing about, you know, it makes your dealing with disputes a lot easier and a lot faster. Now, what has ODR done in the current pandemic, right? You find that a whole lot of institutions have set up protocols and platforms for you to try and have your matters resolved by way of online dispute resolution. The perfect example is that AnswerTrial has got this technical notes on online dispute resolution. It was something that was published a couple of years ago, but it's now come to the forefront. There is the Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation Framework and Model for Procedural Rules on Online Dispute Resolution for Cross-Border B2B Disputes, established by an APEC-sponsored initiative that I was a part of. And it basically sets out a framework on how you can have your matters resolved by online in a systematic manner with a protocol and rules and all of that set in place. There are several other protocols. The International Chamber of Commerce has got this COVID guidance notes for arbitral proceedings. The Chartered Institute of Arbitrators have got this guidance notes for remote dispute resolution. The SOAR protocol on video conferencing for international arbitration, also something that had come up a couple of years back, has now come to the forefront. It was November 2018 that it said. There's also the draft guide for good practice for use of video links under the Hague Evidence Convention, and several others. And what you see is that you've got service providers, you've got platforms on which you can work, and you've got a clear structure on how you get your disputes dealt with online with all of these protocols and rules and regulations set in place. Right now, if you then take all of this and now you try and put it back together with what Professor Iria said, where is the future? Where is it going to lead us? You've got all of this clear framework for doing your matters resolved by online. What does the future then hold? The first thing I think I'd like to highlight is artificial intelligence, which Professor Iria has spoken about. Basically, artificial intelligence is the processing of information through computers, utilizing software algorithm, mimicking or simulating human intelligence, and being developed as a tool to streamline legal process. So the question then you have is this: can you place all of this onto an artificial intelligence platform that would then deal with the matter? My simple answer is this: that we are a long way away from having artificial intelligence dealing with complex issues. But what it can do at the moment is that it can support us in facilitating the dispute resolution and moving it along a lot faster. Some of the examples were what Jesse had spoken about, but it's not strictly artificial intelligence based, where you have a processing of information through an artificial intelligence platform and making decisions, but it is aiding us, right? So, you know, applications of AI to legal data is referred to as legal analytics. And you have things like the smart contracts that you talked about, and you have maybe other aspects of artificial intelligence. But all of this is at the moment only there to aid us in dispute resolution mechanisms. But I don't think we are ready for it to take over. AI technology is further being considered for use in judicial administration for better handling of caseloads. So not making decisions, but for example, better handling of caseloads, managing a large amount of valuable data and comprehending and analyzing this data, assisting with the judiciary process, identifying, organizing and selecting relevant jurisprudence to dealing with certain aspects of the disputes, to help highlight arguments presented by the parties or create arguments presented by the parties. Again, what you see is that the artificial intelligence just helps support the work that we lawyers do. So, you know, rest assured, we are a long way away from our jobs being lost in the process, right? It's also been said that as an interest in machine learning and AI continues to grow, companies are realizing the complexities inherent not only in the technology itself, but in the responsible implementation of technology, best practices around fairness, transparency, accountability, security, and privacy, which Professor Iria has spoken about. So these are all going to be critical issues that you need to consider when you're going to adopt them. But the crux of it is this. We are now in a stage where online dispute resolution is going to be the way forward. It is not going to be a case where, when the pandemic is over, we're going to revert to the old scheme of face-to-face interaction in court. In a webinar that I presented in India about 2 months ago, we had this discussion about whether or not virtual arbitration is really helpful, whether or not you get the sense of the witness and whether or not the witness is being coached in the background. My take on it is this. Those of us who have done arbitration would know that when a witness is speaking, you only have one person you're looking at. But with on a virtual screen, you get to see everybody. So when the witness is speaking, you get to see how the opposing parties are reacting, how the opposing parties deal with the issue, and you get to see them up close and personal. And if you think you're worried about the witness being coached, don't forget you've got documents, you've got statements, you've got all of these things that you as an arbitrator are going to sit there and make a decision on. Surely you're not going to be just flipped just because a witness had been coached into answering or providing the answers that they think that are right. But you get to, as an arbitrator, to sit down and analyze all of this. But you get it upfront and personal because of the virtual environment in which you're dealing with. Right. Again, Jesse spoke, gave you examples of construction industry systems that are in place. Just briefly, if I may just speak quickly about the industry specific technology. You've got augmented and virtual reality that's becoming far more user friendly, especially in the construction industry, I think Jesse showed us that, where you have a 3D view of what exactly happened and took place and what the problem caused. So that's really about virtual reality. And we are looking and moving into the realm of augmented reality, where the reality is set with the data and the information that has been provided in the dispute. And you put that together and you get it into a virtual screen, and you can actually view it, and you'd be taken into the problem. So let's say it's a defect that was caused in a construction site. The virtual reality and augmented reality will take you into the scene itself and recreate it. You have this drone technology. In 2018, the construction industry saw about 240% increase in the adoption of drone technology in surveying and inspecting construction sites. You also have the building information modeling system, and a few other systems that are in place that really puts everything together, right? So in conclusion, what I want you to take away is this. When you talk about online dispute resolution, you've got platforms, you've got service providers, you've got tools, you've got technology that's available, you've got artificial intelligence that can help support it, not help you make decisions. What is important to note is that the current pandemic has changed the way we do things. Significant use and appreciation of technology in mediation has aligned digital technology and is taking places and taking us to far greater position than we ever were before. The Singapore International Dispute Resolution Academy, in a survey they conducted this late this year, right, on what users say about technology, has shown that an incredible amount of people, clients and lawyers, have started to use technology and the platform, virtual platform, in dealing with dispute resolution. The World Economic Forum, in an article on the 14th of July this year, that accompanied the launch of the COVID-19 legacy, a book, said this, that the concurrence and severity of the fault lines mean that we are now in a critical juncture. The potential of change is unlimited and bounds only by our imagination, and the better or for worse. Right. In a book, Richard Susskind, I don't know whether you know who Richard Susskind is, in his book called Online Courts and the Future of Justice, he said that from the perspective of the judiciary, the possibility of online courts being conducted remotely and extended courts with features of guide users, especially non-expert ones, through the procedure, and concludes that such technology-enabled innovation is fundamentally uncontroversial. We are now in a world where technology is going to aid us, and you'd find that if you take that onto the online dispute resolution platform, you're going to find that you move matters a lot faster. I presented two papers in 2016 and 2019 in the Asian Journal of Mediation, and I spoke extensively about online dispute resolution. And the COVID-19 has actually brought us into the forefront of all of that. All right, and then I think I'll end there, and then I can deal with questions. And I hope I've kind of put together what all three speakers have spoken about, and how that in reality works when we talk about online dispute resolution. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anil. And yes, I think you've done really a good job of putting together the nuggets out of the presentations from the other speakers. And it really was a relief to hear that the technology is not likely to take over the role of the decision making, but rather that it can go very far in aiding as a tool to get towards the decision. So that makes us feel less insecure and fun and joke aside, more comfortable with the idea of whether there are ethical questions that are answered more in line with what we're more comfortable with, that humans ultimately make decisions that affect humans, but they may use the technology to assist them. So I want to thank all three of you. I actually have been scanning the Q&A box, not seeing any questions there. I had asked the host whether we could reduce the time to about 10 minutes. But I had some questions, which, if you don't mind, I would like to pose. One of the things that I've been thinking about from Professor Jufrida's presentation is this question of data protection and privacy, and all the obligations that come up with the handling of sensitive data. And I was thinking that several countries have different degrees of sophistication in their laws and structures in terms of obligations. You know, how some countries have gone quite sophisticated and detailed in their data protection and privacy management in terms of their laws, and some countries have not yet passed data protection legislation, or, you know, kept up with where the world is now. How do you or any other member of the panel see these vulnerabilities in the handling of data and sensitive data, in terms of just creating a realistic, fair environment, which gives no advantage to, say, the more sophisticated jurisdictions and seats than the less sophisticated ones?
I'm going to give a stab at, the other panelists will have their own views. I would like to distinguish the variety of legal regimes for different types of data. For instance, in the US, there's a regime for medical data, there's a regime for data that relates to students, and I need to be very conscious of that as a professor, and so on and so forth. In Europe, we have the General Data Protection Regulation and another different regime. The legal regulation inevitably, just like you were saying, may have extraterritorial effect, but have a limited kind of effect. And so the kind of problem that I would like to present to you is Imagine a European resident, so in theory protected by the GDPR, that downloads several applications, for instance, has a Fitbit. Now, the Fitbit collects a wealth of data, including data that in the US would categorize as health data, but would not be protected by HIPAA because it's not withheld by a medical authority, but it's been provided for free, which is that's what we do, right? We give up our digital universe of information. So the problem is that legal system can only do so much. The other component that I think is very important is educating consumers, because we leave digital fingerprints throughout all the devices. And I see Jesse nodding, because this is also captured, for instance, in litigation. So leaving this digital fingerprints and not appreciating that certain important personal information have a lot of value. So that's problem number one. The second problem, and then I'll stop talking, is that collecting different pockets of data still allows entities that have access in different ways to these separate pockets of data to triangulate. And I think an experiment was done relatively recently. There was a bit of a scandal with Netflix based on three separate and unrelated data points about individuals living in a specific address. They could determine the race of that individual. And so the profile, you know, the artwork for the movies that were presented different racial actors based on the race of the viewer, which is extremely troubling on so many different levels. So the short answer is that I think every legal system should think very carefully about data. I think it's extremely difficult, if not impossible, to have a worldwide harmonized legal structure. But I think that the key is educating us as consumers in being a little bit more jealous and more guarded about the data that we volunteer. I heard somebody saying that George Orwell would be horrified because the Big Brother, the imposition, that the spying was done from the outside in. In our society, it's done from us. We volunteer. You know, I go on Facebook. I give it all out. So I'll stop there.
Thanks so much, Iria. It's really true. We give away so much. You know, you're surfing on something and a pop-up comes up and do you agree to this? And you click on that. And I don't know if Anil and Jesse had any weigh-ins on that.
Yeah, if I could just add to that, there are encryptions and there are user passwords, VPNs, two-factor authentication and all that. And so it's actually very important that if you're going to go on the online dispute resolution platform, you turn to a secured system, all right? And that's why both Jesse and I gave you examples of the platforms that are available, the service providers that are available. They have actually enhanced their technology. I mean, when we started this pandemic, Zoom had a serious problem and they had to sort that out. So you must be rest assured that, you know, that while there is a fear about a personal data protection and all of that, that fear is more of just a fear than what the reality is. If the reality is that if you use really credible systems, the security is there. You know, you don't have to be fearful that, you know, we come on a webinar like this and all our data just seeps out. You know, and Jesse would testify totally to that, you know, in arbitrations and all that, the systems that are available and what they use are so encrypted and so secured that it really doesn't, you know, disappear on the dark web or wherever. You know, it's secured. So you must be, people must be assured that there are some safeties in place and securities are available.
And I think, Anil, if I can follow up on that point, I agree with the fact that the practitioner, it's the responsibility of the practitioner, and that is both the lawyer and arbitration centers to find products that provide this degree of support and educate the users of those products. But on the other side, I suspect that I look at it a little bit more academically than I do practically. If somebody's hell-bent to crack a system, and if somebody has perhaps the support of a nation state behind them, they will crack a system, right? Mm. So it's also managing the expectations. I suspect that nobody would be interested in a commercial arbitration, but when we talk about investor states, when we talk about perhaps disputes between defense companies, etc., the stakes are much higher. And so the degree of education of the users needs to be appropriate to the fact that it's small, but it's still a risk that exists.
I want to use moderator's privilege and just ask this question. We have one question coming up from one of our attendees, and I'm just going to read it. I know you didn't miss it, questioner, but it is, the question is there consideration for integrating what I think is body detection software into ODR? For example, the use of software which monitors pupil dilation, changes in voice, body movements such as twitches, squinting, etc.
I've read about it, and I think those are things that are coming online and eventually would be made available. But the point then is this: if I'm sitting as an arbitrator and I'm watching all of you, how much of that system do I want to use to make decisions? You know, and you know, it's about algorithm and the mechanics of that. Professor Iria would know that better. But would I rather rely on my own instinct to decide whether all of you are paying attention or dozing off, as opposed to using a software to make that decision? It'll aid me, yes, to some extent, but a lot of it still has to be my gut feeling, I would think.
Well, I was happy to hear that answer, because I remember Professor Jufrida's example, the image of the person's face is before the screen and it's not detected. You put a paper and it's detected. It's fascinating. I see Professor McCoy, Dr. McCoy, in one of my windows, and that's the signal that we need to wrap up our reasoning. We use these sort of gentle hints that, you know, once the video opens, now it's time to retreat. So let me take the hint and begin the retreat. Ladies and gentlemen, this really has been a wonderful experience for me, an honor for me to host this, to moderate this panel of obviously capable, distinguished experts who have demonstrated from their practice and their work known competence in their area. And to thank you for spending your afternoon reasoning with us, and to hope for, look forward to, on your behalf or together, the next installment of Coffee Time, which Dr. Malcolm no doubt will let us know about in due course. Thanks, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. McCoy?
Thank you very much, Carolyn, and thank you and your panel for a really wonderful, thought-provoking session. I certainly learned something, and I'm sure, like I think we all did. We all will take different things away from this. The message I took away, especially from Anil's contribution, is that we're at the beginning, not the end of this process. You know, we're trying to make ourselves more adept, more equipped to understand the new technology in our profession. And we are at the beginning, it seems, rather than anywhere near the end. The panel behaved very well. You know, they didn't provoke too many arguments. And such, we're more or less back on time, back on track. And there are a lot of persons that we'll have to thank for this. And we have our colleague, Victor Barrett, who will ask in a few minutes to go through that process of thanking everyone who's worked so hard, including our panelists and our moderators, to make this evening a success, I think it is.
Good evening, colleagues. Good morning, good night, wherever you are. It is indeed a pleasure for me to move this vote of thanks, you know, on behalf of JAIC. It is indeed, it was a wonderful event, and I'm sure we all have learned something. It is the way forward, it is here with us, and so we have to recalibrate how we do things. I want to say a big thank you to Professor McCoy for being skillful chair, managing the program, you know, the way it ought to be. Also want to say a big thank you to our moderator, Queen's Counsel, Caroline Hay, for doing a wonderful job. Nothing less was expected. And our dear Minister Vaz, who brought greetings and also his commitment to support the work of the JAIC, and Justice Roy Anderson for giving us greetings. Our expert panelists, you know, it is indeed for me, it was interesting, it was enlightening, and very educational. Professor Iria Giuffrida, she spoke about AI and algorithms and how, you know, how it is useful in modern world. The issue of privacy is of paramount importance, and that is something that, you know, countries, our moderator spoke about different countries with different data protection act, what is in place to secure the issue of privacy. Mr. Jesse Francis, he showcased, you know, an excellent presentation on how you can use the technology, how you can facilitate showcasing expert witness, 3D dimension view of varying issues. You know, it was quite interesting and informative. And Mr. Anil from Singapore, you know, he twinned both presentations, and then we looked at how, you know, the online dispute resolution, how it, you know, it is important. And whilst there may be challenges, you know, with AI, then it is not a lost cause, right? We can develop and move forward. It is here to stay. And despite the challenges and their opportunities, because, you know, the issue of cost savings, the convenience, the eco-friendly use of this platform, you know. So he twinned both presentation, and he gave us a holistic view of what online dispute resolution is all about. So it was a good time from all the panelists, you know, informative and very educational. Nonetheless, we need to say also a big thank you to our sponsors, because without our sponsors, then this event would not have been, you know, available for us to participate in. So we have the Jamaica Standard Products, Caribbean Development Bank, ADMB Consultants, CP Malcolm Dispute Management Practitioner, Island Blue Jamaica Mountain Coffee, Caribbean Producers Jamaica Limited, Jane Bank, Garden Group, Jamaica Stock Exchange, Changaroff Chambers LLC, Exim Bank, Money Musk Rums, Jamaica Deposit Insurance Corporation, Trial Media Litigation Support Services, COK Solidarity Credit Union, and Barrett Law. Our media practitioners, Hype TV, Loom News, Trend Media Limited, and we must not forget the hardworking team of the JAIC, Dr. Christopher Malcolm, Secretary General, and his team, Ms. Nadia Henry, Marketing, Communication, and Administration, Mr. Marlon Griffiths for IT support, Mr. Akeem Wilson, Admin Support, Tamika Campbell, Admin Support, and Denise Erkin Jones for Sales Support. So, all in all, with everybody coming on board, this event, in my mind, and I'm sure with all our participants, you know, was a success. And, you know, it is the way forward. And we are hoping that the next webinar, which will be on the 17th of February, 2021, then we can have more attendees from all over the world, because as our moderator and our panelists, you know, articulated that education is important, and we need to start to sensitize, you know, those who are against this sort of online resolution, dispute resolution. So for the proponents of online dispute resolution, we have to showcase the pros and the cons, and to let let them understand that it is the way forward. And, you know, it can assist in how we handle business and all over the world. And as Anil spoke about, you know, the convenience, you can, once you can be anywhere, once you can log on and you can showcase and do your business. So all in all, it was a wonderful, wonderful webinar. And I want to thank all the panelists and all the participants, wherever you are. And I do trust that, you know, you'll enjoy the Christmas season and a wonderful 2021 and stay COVID-free. I thank you all.
Thank you very much, Victor. And I'm sure we, for the rest of us, you know, we're happy for you, for your new years and of course Chris's participation in this to help us drive this process. May I say, let the learning continue, because we all want to be better lawyers, better practitioners, better ADR practitioners. Mm-hmm. Finally, colleagues, it has come, it's been a long but not painful day, a very pleasant afternoon for me at least, and I'm sure I hope it is for you as well. So can we now call up on our musical treat, we describe it on the program, mm-hmm. The musical agenda has Herzon Clark, is he around? Can Herzon come in? And may I say goodbye to you all. Thank you very much for participating and coming.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the very talented Herzon with the Voice Grip Band. Herzon's new album will be released in 2021. Make sure you follow him on social media. Yeah. Herzon Live. Feeling.
I could give a damn what this world thinks of me. Got the right to be who I wanna be. Staying true to my identity. In this world of hypocrisy, yes, I've got my morals and belief. I owe firm to the Almighty. Like the wild horse running the prairies, let me be wild and free. Like the lion in the jungle, wild and free. Like the eagle soaring the mountain, it's my life, it's my world. I've got my right here reserved to be wild and free. Just let me be. And I sing along, eh, 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 eh. Some people live their lives by heiresses and so-called no-yos. If you were bad advice, yes, then deny you one might ever talk, yeah. What is meant to be mindful of when the arms of men will fail you? Yes, I refuse to be what you want me to be. Yes, yeah, I'm that I am. Wild and free, like the lion in the jungle. Wild and free, like the eagle soar the mountain. It's my life, it's my world. I've got my right here reserved to be wild and free. Just let me be. Yes, sing along. Well, you know, let me style it so that's it. What it represent, the true rebel in me. And I leave my own to religious controversies, cause I hold firm to the one and only. Wild and free, like the lion in the jungle. Wild and free, like the eagle soaring the mountain. It's my life, it's my world. I've got my right here reserved to be wild and free. Like the lion, dedicate this one to the world. Number one, yeah. Hey, now that the thing turn up, things sign and seal up. Love when we have shut the road, and I what them a go do. Oh, 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 oh. And I know why you feel oh, 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 oh. Everything brighter, the world know why you run the turf, yes. And I want them all to do, oh, 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 oh. And I know why you may love, oh, 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 oh. Hey. Some send BB and some send letter, some message Facebook and some send Twitter. Yeah, but between me and me wife, cancel them application like the US Embassy. And as some of them bare face, yes, eh? See people property and want me running. Look like a something out the Lord of the Rings. Baby, me I tell you, don't you worry. I will learn. Get up and be. Give me the whole world. Love how we have shut the road. I know what them a good do. I know why you may love. That's an a ring palm finger. Everything brighter. The world know why you run the turf. I know what them a good do. Yes, I know why you may love. Them can't see me cook up at the rice. Tell them figure steam a one fish. And if for pretty looks, them can't test you now. And in a bedroom, then I have no use now. Now they never could come between us. Genuine love is what they need. Baby, you should know that I will love. Can't come between. You mean the old world to me. Can't come between, no. Never gonna leave you when don't wanna take your place. And I'm so proud to say you're the worthy. Though that the thing turn up, you sign a seal up. Love what we have shut the road. Yes, I what they're not gonna do. Oh, oh, oh. I guess I know why you're below. Oh, 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 oh. You know, see, say, ring my finger. Everything brighter. They will know why you're on the turn. I know what they might do. Oh, oh, oh. Yes, I know why you're below. Oh, 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 oh. I tell you what they might do. Oh, 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 oh. Yes, I know why you're below. Oh, oh, oh. You know, see, say, what they might do. Oh, oh, oh. Yes, I know why you're below. Oh, oh, oh. Yeah! Sometimes we argue, sometimes we fight, baby. That don't mean oh, soldiers are made for war. Boxers are made for the ring, babe. I was made to love you, baby. Let's just stop this arguing. Ain't too proud to say I'm sorry. Ain't too proud to say please. Here and now I present the truth. Cause I believe that if we find a way for us to stay together, you and I could brighten up the world together. Shine like a star that's never lost its glow. Forever and ever and always. You and I could be the sun wonder. Teach your world out of love. Shine like the stars, never lost its glow. Forever and ever and always. Yeah, baby, and we've been together for the years and the face and the smile. Now there's just no way. No way, I'm gonna give up when I will love you. Cause I truly appreciate all the years you have given me. And sincerely, baby, I'm counting on eternity, yeah. If we find a way for us to stay together, you and I could brighten up the world together. shine like a star that's never lost its glow. Forever, but I could be the seventh wonder. Teach your world how to love each other, baby. Like a star that's never lost its glow. Brighten up the world together. Shine like a star that's never lost its glow. Forever, always, you and I could be the seventh wonder. Teach your world how to love each other, yeah. And like a star that's never lost its glow. Forever. Me and the great Shaggy did a song together about 2009 called Two Places. And what I realized is there's no new song in this world, no new concept. It's just the same old, it's just new voices, new interpretations, you know? And so, since I realized that we got these vibes from this old school thing, this old school music, feels so good. I decided I want to touch a little piece of it before I go into that, the original song, you know? Take it away from me, ladies, yeah. Me, darling.
Hope you enjoying the vibes, you know? Loving it here, you don't know. Good vibes, good reggae music to the heart, the mind, and the soul, you know? Take it down a little. Blessed love, you know? Yeah. Man, let me get a vibe to write a love song. Kiss me and press on her cheek, say I won't be long. Hit the streets, pick up a spliff on a one dragon. You know to hold a mess in this summer video. When we reach a stoplight, grab the vibe. Young baby girl, prostitute in a daylight. Hungry belly, you stand care, glass of wine. When I beg left for about food in a me car from last night. Like a horror movie, gives me the creeps. Babylon, I keep down stars, set them a clean the streets. No provisions made for the vendors to eat. Tax increase for poor people every week. Do you heard of empty promises? Do you heard of young peers and pretty speech? Never cash but a big tree and up. Yes, wanna get a thing. But the system is so unfair. Give us strength to face the problem. Lord, hear my cry. Just want to survive. But the system is so unfair. Give us strength to face the problem. Do 20 push up and that never work. 20 more and me whole body drop a day. Why squad and hungry belly and mess with me girls? Yes, one bag of subjects and can't get no work. Artists willing for the pocket weak. The adversity you sleep on cool concrete. Politicians how you see that and go bed, go sleep. Feeling on the heart and your body get weak. Sometimes I see things when me cry my love about. Sometimes I think I pray a little too much. No more space on my knees to kneel. Blessed as I'm gone from over praying. Lord, I just want to survive, yeah. But the system is so unbearable. Yes, give us strength to face tomorrow. Lord, hear my crying. I just want to survive. But the system is so unbearable. Give us strength to face tomorrow. Now ask if he goes, now if he bends. All I need is basic necessity. Just enough to feed me and my family, Lord, yes. Basic necessity. Basket in a kitchen, but it's empty. Build food in a pocket, but it's empty. All these talks are trim my energy. Lord, I'm right now, 'cause it's a good old people song, and only we alone can sing this song. Yes, and this is a song for the poor that's made separation. Yes, it's a get up in the sun, and only we alone can sing it. It's a song for the poor that's faced in separation. Lord, hear my cry. I just wanna survive. The system is so unbearable. Give us strength to face tomorrow. Lord, hear my cry. Man, I just wanna survive. But the system is so unbearable. Give us strength to face tomorrow. Almost every 5 miles is a state of emergency set up, you know. And I feel it for my city, the city that I love so much, people that I love so much. So I sang this song called Mobe. Thank you. On the streets, tapping feet, smiling faces everywhere. Glad to meet lovely peeps, when love we greet and share. Where have you gone now? Things ain't the same since you lived. Now bloody streets still feet. Angry faces and no one cares. Misguided daughters and sons initiated in this killing game. Where have you gone now? I really wish you'd come back today. My baby, please come back. My baby. To the streets of the land, he's coming, my baby. Yeah. I really miss your beautiful face. Where have you gone now, my baby? Things ain't the same since you lay. That's something I always would recommend you do. Remember when we used to do and be caring and giving? Now we seem no more for robbing and killing ya. And even talk outside to we neighbor. Cause them a youth so them not have no same behavior. Yes, all them speeches no must call them a boy. Seems there's no love anymore.
This one goes out on behalf of all men on this planet Earth. I want to dedicate this song to that woman. You stood at times when standing was impossible, and you smiled when crying wasn't all. You committed when commitment was unreliable, and you stayed calm in the midst of the storm. And I believe you can fly, yeah. You could just try, 'cause you're a superwoman. I believe you can fly, yeah. If you just try, 'cause you're a superwoman. Mothers of superstars, leaders and presidents, such great achievements, you did it both by yourself, yeah.
Broken
heart and soul with a blissful grin, yeah. Hidden sorrows and pain you disguise so well. I believe you can fly, yeah. If you just try, superwoman. I believe you can fly, fly, yeah. If you just try, 'cause you're a superwoman. And it's amazing how you carry such heavy load, as if it's light as a feather floating on the soul. Save Joanna, who could save Christy? I believe you can. I know that you can take the wings of the morning and fly. Big up, Miss Muff. I know that you can take the wings of the morning and fly, 'cause you are a. We leave with this song called Fly, you know. It's another song in my overseas, my Europe, that they love so much. And I never do. This one goes out to all our people, them. See? I don't even talk. Hear the song. This is our time, you know. Just fly. Jews know this song.
Just put your hand up in the sky, 'cause this is your season to fly. Just put your troubles aside, you got a reason, oh child. Point your hands to the sky, 'cause this is your season to fly. when the troubles of life try to get you down, yeah. Brush it off with a smile, yeah, yeah. And I listen to those three little birds standing at your doorstep singing, hey, don't you worry about a thing, cause everything's gonna be alright. Oh child, hey, just put you hand up in the sky, cause this is your season to fly. Just put your troubles aside, you got a reason. Oh child, point your hands to the sky, cause this is your season to fly. As a way of providing for the birds in the sky, the fish in the sea, the butterfly. Yeah. Hey, so don't you worry about a thing. No negative energy, no. Just brush it off, sign it off. Raise up and shine. But you end up in the sky, cause this is the season. Now put your troubles aside, you gotta. Point your hands to the sky, for this is a season to fly. Hey, just remember nothing in life don't come easy. And through the stress, the pain, the hard work, please believe me. Cause if you only travel a sunny day, you will never reach your destination. But with a strong will, determination, I guarantee you, yeah. Hey, that's what you end up in the sky, cause this is your season to fly. Just put your troubles aside, and you got a reason, oh child. Point your hands to the sky, cause this is your season to fly. Everybody know that this time is your time. Put your hands up. You got a reason. Everybody put them out of the air and wave it. Just fly. Cause I know, one more time it's their time. Hey, just put your hand up in the sky. Though this is your season. And you gotta know, just put your troubles aside. Thank you for having me. Having us on stage and the boys get back. No, big up Maria. Big up Tamar. Spokes are following. Thank you.
Sponsors: Jamaica Standard Products, Caribbean Development Bank, ADEB Consultants, CP Malcolm Dispute Management Practitioner, Island Blue Jamaica Mountain Coffee, Caribbean Producers Jamaica Limited, JM Bank, Guardian Group, Jamaica Stock Exchange, Changaroth Chambers LLC, Exim Bank, Money Musk Runs, Jamaica Deposit Insurance Corporation, Trial Media Litigation Support Services, Media Partners, Hype TV, and Trend Media Limited.